We had a fairly small group, very select group, talking about publication ethics and in the context of OASPA. And you know, our starting point really is it's one of the important reasons for OASPA existing in the first place. The idea that we want to promote good standards and improve standards of publishing. And so, you know, this is our mission statement, and then to accomplish this mission, the association will do various things. And one of the things that's highlighted there is this promotion of standards in best practices in terms of things like the ethics of publishing. And of course, by doing that, you promote, you know, all the other things that we want to do as well, because the better we do that, the more we can advocate for open access publishing. It's obviously connected with the idea of education and so on. So, you know, publishing ethics is really important to us. So one of the things that we do, one of the practical things that we do to try and achieve that is to have selection criteria for members, unlike so most other, I think, publishing associations. And so when a new member applies, they go through a reasonable sort of level of scrutiny to look at various aspects of what they do. And so these are our membership criteria. So things like we need to know what type of organization they are. They need to have a business address. This is kind of fairly basic stuff. Like to see a complaint policy. If they have publication fees, then that information needs to be clearly available. Peer review, some form of peer review is required, and it has to be clearly described. But most important, really, in the context of this is that they have to comply with what we call a code of conduct. So was really the starting point for our discussion, is this good enough? Actually, this is the first half of it. So, but what's missing? So we sort of went through this, and so just briefly, you know, the first thing is just a general comment that you mustn't do anything that's going to bring OASPA get us into trouble. Again, company information needs to be provided, that we emphasize the business of peer review, and that whatever form of peer review is done, it needs to be clearly described. And that there need to be editorial boards associated with the journals that are kind of recognized experts. If there are fees, then it needs to be clearly stated. Direct marketing activities, and this is actually something that was right at the beginning of OASPA, was one of the things that was being highlighted as there's some rather unsavory practices being indulged in by certain new entrants into the publishing marketplace. And so that was something that we felt really, it wasn't doing open access any good whatsoever. And so one of the reasons for forming OASPA was to try and figure out a way of improving that, and we're demonstrating that open access publishing as a whole is free from that kind of nonsense, and we all behave properly. So we spent a bit more time talking about that. The licensing policy needs to be clearly identified. Instructions to authors need to be clearly shown, and if there is any misconduct, then it's likely to be reported to the board of directors. So what was missing was identified fairly quickly as a preservation, something to do with preservation. So it was felt by our gang that we really needed to put something in, and it really should be a requirement. Not maybe a requirement for entry into the organization, but a requirement for, after a certain period, say of 12 months or something like that. Because we felt there are reasonable ways of doing this which should be within reach of pretty much any publisher now. There's very little cost associated with them. So the two, and it's a critical function of the publishing process. So the two possibilities are to look at LOCs, which is Lots of Copies Keep Stuff Safe, which is probably familiar with, most of you are familiar with. And it's a kind of distributed archiving mechanism. And we needed to investigate whether this could be done through the DOAJ, and I wasn't sure about that. Is Lars here, actually? See you? Oh, yes.
Yeah.
So maybe that's a question. So what can you say anything about what did we think? How did we think it might work?
Well, as I understand, Lars, isn't now the Royal Library in the Netherlands archiving the journals that are in the DOAJ?
Which is
on your...
Yeah,
roll-up, I think.
I think we are saying securing permanent access through eDepot at KB in the heart, which means that it is a project in progress.
Okay.
So we are sending bulks of journal content to the Royal Library on various intervals. We first have to collect the full text, and journals should first provide us with metadata on article level, which only 42% of the journals in the DOAJ as of today is able to do. So this is a sort of a long journey. So it will not be tomorrow, right, that all the journals are there, but there will be an increasing number. It's basically a question of funding and support to the work that needs to be done.
Thank you. So I guess that probably means in the short term we need to be looking at locks as the first possible. So we just need to look at how practical it is, really, and whether it's just asking too much for all publishers to work in that way. And the suggestion was made that we might even consider establishing a locks node associated somehow with OASPA. So, and again, I don't know what the practicalities of that are. Another thing that we felt could, if we could make it happen, would be really good, would be to establish some kind of formal arrangement with COPE, the other COPE, the Committee on Publishing Ethics, because a lot of us are members, a lot of the larger publishers are members of COPE. It's a fantastic organization which has a ton of useful information about publishing ethics. And being a member of COPE comes with some real tangible benefits in terms of practical help in steering your way through some difficult ethical territory sometimes. So if we could figure out a way, a bit like we've done with Crossref, to have particularly scholar publishers, a sort of a cheaper way for them to become members of COPE, then I think that's something that we felt we should explore. I think that was the missing part. And then, so that was that part. And then the next thing was really to sort of try and encourage and recommend good practice. And there's lots of resources that we felt we could highlight. So, for example, again, going back to COPE, there's a ton of stuff we could highlight on our pages about certain aspects of publishing practices. Carrie Calder from BMC very kindly volunteered to help us on the issue of email marketing in particular. So we had a bit of a conversation about that, which is quite interesting. And I think Carrie seemed to be the most knowledgeable person in the room about some of those issues. And so there are almost certainly best practice guidelines which we can point to. And the most important thing is simply to follow the legislation. There's an act in the US called the Can-Spam Act. And European legislation, I think, is more complicated generally because there's more of it. So we'll provide some recommendations on that, which I think will be helpful. Then we also talked about the issue of dual publication. This was something Ulrich Pöschel mentioned this morning and was keen to talk about. We talked about coordinated versus duplicate publication, and sort of providing information about that would be helpful. And also to look into, in sort of vaguely connected with the idea of duplicate publication, a facility called CrossCheck, which is provided by Crossref and is a tool for detecting plagiarism in submitted articles. So again, you know, there may be a way of some publishers are already using CrossCheck, but there may be a way of again making that impossible for some of the smaller publishers to use CrossCheck. So again, we need to look at that, see if it's feasible. And then another topic that we talked about, and this isn't really an exhaustive list, I think this has just highlighted some of the things that would be good to publish them, put some links up about the relationship with sponsors, in particular commercial sponsors. The importance of achieving editorial independence at all times in any kind of relationship with a sponsor, and being completely transparent about that relationship, the role of the sponsor, and obviously any kind of competing interests and things like that. So those are the kinds of things that we can add to a resources page. And then the last thing, really, the last idea, was to sort of celebrate the great work that is being done by OASPA members, to really kind of take a positive stance on this, And you know, not to make it look like we're sort of providing all these membership criteria because, well, you know, OA publishers are terrible. You know, we need all these. That's ridiculous. You know, we don't want to give that impression. We want to celebrate the fact that actually OA publishers are doing a really great job. And so, you know, we were thinking about how to do that, and probably the blog actually is the best mechanism that we have. And so we're talking about sort of having highlighting certain activities, and it probably would be best if they weren't highlighted by the people who are actually doing them, because then it would look too much like a marketing exercise. So it might be better if we could somehow have them reviewed. So that was, these are just ideas at this point, but we thought that they had merit. And again, it would demonstrate the focus that we have on improving standards in publishing ethics. And sort of going back to the beginning would help to promote the whole idea of open access publishing as well. So what did I miss?
I'm just
going to
look, but I think you covered all.
Mark, just on that last point about highlighting. On the last point of highlighting really good stuff from open access publishers, we talked yesterday about the possibility of like collaborating with Faculty of 1000. Just thinking about it, it'd be a really nice feature on the OASPA homepage, or no, on the site, to have a little feed of the most recent OASPA journal articles that have been highlighted there. And obviously there are other sources of similar kind of information, but it'd be a nice ongoing stream of high quality research.
That's a nice idea. Yeah, I think anything we can do like that is going to be worthwhile. Any other?
Is there any other feedback, either from people from the session? Or?
Well, I'm wearing my wiki hat here now, and I just Googled...
Do you have any other hats?
I do.
<joking. laughs>
We can talk about brain morphometry, but I don't think that's too much of interest to many here. So I just Googled a bit in different wikis what the coverage of OASPA and open access is, and it's not very well developed. So if any of you are interested in that, I'm happy to lend a hand.
That's very kind. Thank you.
Anybody else? Oh.
I have to say that the locks kind of thing was an interesting one that you were hinting at, because it's a bit of a quantum leap. It's a bit a passage between a very soft kind of services that you are offering. We highlight this, we highlight that, we look of ethics, which is the kind of things you do on a website, onto something which is slightly more hard, into allowing people who are in to benefit from something which is almost mission critical, in the sense that helps you say, oh, I'm going to be there forever, so give me the papers. This is a first step. I wonder whether OASPA thought about starting to offer a much more technical kind of services for those who are too small to afford. For those publishers who are too small to afford some kind of technical services, I'm thinking content hosting, I'm thinking reference linking, I'm thinking centralized bulk discount copy editing for those who are one-person operation journal who can do copy editing themselves. You just negotiate a better price and so on and so forth. This, of course, starts to become a totally different operation. But the question to you is, maybe in this long tail of 2,000 publishers, there is a market to be offered these things. Of course, this means you need staff and so on. I don't know if everybody's thinking about that. Sorry, I should have looked also at you. You were just not as nice a mark.
Yeah, actually, I'll respond to that a little bit. I probably should have said some more at the beginning of the conference here about the recent agreement we've got with Crossref, because I think it's really important, and it's one of the most concrete things we've done as an organization. So we've recently signed an agreement with Crossref so that any OASPA member, particularly the small independent journals, will be able to get DOIs via OASPA without having to pay any money to Crossref directly. So there are, now OASPA will incur costs in doing this. It's not as though Crossref is giving us free DOIs or anything, but that this would be considered a member benefit. So up to, I think we're talking about 50 DOIs a year. Any OASPA member would be able to get 50 DOIs a year for their articles. Because again, that's something that's very important, and most of the smaller publishers are just not in a position to join Crossref as an organization. And that will also extend, in theory, to CrossCheck. Now, again, there's a cost associated with that, so we need to make sure that it's viable for us as an organization. But hopefully we will be able to let the smaller publishers use CrossCheck in order to check their submissions for plagiarism. And I hope we can do that at a very reasonable cost.
I just want to add, Paul, that the Crossref agreement is for the scholar publishers.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't expect publishing organizations.
Yeah, we certainly are not going to get away with not paying for our DOIs. But for the long tail of smaller publishers, and really one of the hopes was it's something that can concretely be of value to these small publishers who may say, why should I join OASPA? What am I going to get from this? I can't come to the meetings. I don't have the resources to participate actively. And hopefully being able to offer something like reference linking at no direct cost will be a real benefit to bring in some of these smaller members. Okay, any other comments?
What about real IT services, centralized IT services?
Centralized IT services.
I don't need to run 50 OJS systems adjusting the password on your one.
Oh. Yeah. You wanna take that on, Salvatore?
Well, we do have. Yeah, well, we do have Knowledge Exchange, and we do need to make this more visible. Knowledge Exchange has offered also a reduced rate on their hosting services for our members. So we are trying to agree other agreements, and we're very open to others coming to us as well that might like to capture that long tail, as you say, because I do think that that is correct. You have this huge long tail that's kind of being ignored. And though in many cases their resources are limited, they may have some. And some of those resources can give them a real lift. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very difficult for OASPA as basically a volunteer organization to do any of these things ourselves. So we are looking for partners who can we can work with, and I think we provide value. I mean, for Crossref, the reason they decided to sign this agreement with us is that they don't want to deal with hundreds of independent journals. It's just administratively very difficult for them. So they figured if we're already dealing with these publishers, it makes sense for us to act as an intermediary. And I think the same can be said for hosting and for production services and for all sorts of other things. But we don't envision that we're going to be providing these services directly ourselves.